If you'll switch me over, please. I want you to turn with me to the book of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel. We've been emphasizing and talking about dealing with breaking the spirit of offense. We've been talking about how dangerous it is for us to be bound by this spirit, and that it is the trap of Satan to bind us up and to cause us to abort our destinies. It is a setup by the enemy to destroy us and to keep us from coming to the place, to the plan and the purpose of God for our lives. And it is so dangerous, as we have said and we have emphasized, that Jesus references in Matthew 18 in conjunction with the fact that he says that if your hand offends you, if your cut it off, if your eye offends you, pluck it out. He's telling you that offense is so bad, he said, because it's better to go into heaven in the kingdom of God with one eye than it is to go in with both eyes. In other words, offense will keep you out of the kingdom of God. It'll keep you from the purpose of God. It'll keep you from the destiny in which God has for your life. And then also, we shared last week out of Matthew 5, when Jesus talked about that if you hate your brother without a cause, and talks about the fact of if you say to your brother Reka, he said that you will be in jeopardy of the judgment of hellfire. So he makes it very, very clear that this is a very, very important thing, and none of us want to be bound by offense. The Apostle Paul says in the book of Acts that he, of a good conscience, was void of offense against any man and against God. And so offense, praise God, can not only block you from your relationships with other people, your horizontal relationships, but it also can affect your vertical relationship, your relationship with God. Amen. And so I want to share out of the 25th chapter of 1 Samuel. The 25th chapter of 1 Samuel. I want to share this story of David, and then I want to try to apply it to this message today that we want to give today. I don't know about you, but I want to reach my destiny. I want to fulfill the plan of God for my life. 1 Samuel 25, and we're going to begin at the first verse. We're going to read quite a few scriptures. Follow along, and then we're going to share the points of emphasis that I believe God's given us to share. 1 Samuel, the 25th chapter, starting at the first verse, and it says, "And Samuel died, and all Israelites were gathered together and lamented him and buried him in his house at Ramah. And David arose and went down to the wilderness of Paran. And there was a man in Maon whose possessions were in Carmel. And the man was very great, and he had 3,000 sheep and 1,000 goats, and he was shearing his sheep in Carmel. Now the name of the man was Nabal, and the name of his wife was Abigail. And she was a woman of good understanding and of a beautiful countenance, but the man was a churlish and an evil in his doings, and he was of the house of Caleb. And David heard in the wilderness that Nabal did shear his sheep. And David sent out 10 young men And David said unto the young men, get you up to Carmel, and go to Nabal, and greet him in my name. And thus shall ye say to him that liveth in prosperity, peace both to thee, and peace be to thy house, and peace be unto all that thou hast. And now I have heard that thou hast shearers. Now thy shepherds which were with us, we hurt them not, neither was there aught missing unto them all the while that they were in Carmel. Ask thy young men, and they will show thee. Wherefore, let the young men find favor in thine eyes, for we come in a good day. Give, I pray thee, whatsoever cometh to thine hand unto thy servants and to thy son David. And when David's young men came, they spake to Nabal according to all those words in the name of David, and ceased. And Nabal answered David's servants and said, who is David, and who is the son of Jesse? There are many servants now a days that break away every man from his master. Shall I then take my bread and my water and my flesh that I have killed for my shears and give it unto men whom I know not whence they be? So David's young men turned their way and went again and came and told him all those sayings. And David said unto his men, gird ye up on every man his sword. And they girded on every man his sword, and David also girded on his sword. And there went up after David about 400 men, and 200 abode in the stuff. But one of the young men told Abigail, Nabal's wife, saying, behold, David sent messengers out of the wilderness to salute our master, and he railed on him. But the men were very good to us, and we were not hurt, neither we miss we anything, as long as we were conversant with them. And when we were in the fields, they were all a wall unto us both by night and day, all the while that we were with them keeping the sheep. Now therefore know and consider that what thou wilt do, for evil is determined against our master and against all his household. For he is such a son of Belial that a man cannot speak to him. Then Abigail made haste, took 200 loaves, 2 bottles of wine, 5 sheep ready dressed, and 5 measures of parched corn, and 100 clusters of raisins, and 200 cakes of figs, and laid them on asses. And she said unto her servants, go on before me, behold, I come after you. But she told not her husband Nabal. And it was so, as she rode on the ass, that she came down by the covert of the hill, and behold, David and his men came down against her, and she met them. Now David had said, surely in vain have I kept all that this fellow hath in the wilderness, so that nothing was missed of all that pertaineth unto him, and he requireth me evil for my good. So and more also do God unto the enemies of David, if I leave of all that pertain unto him by the morning light any that pisses against the wall. And when Abigail saw David, she hastened, lighted off of her ass, and fell before David on her face, and bowed herself to the ground, and fell at his feet, and said, upon me, my Lord, upon me let this iniquity be. Let thine handmaid, I pray thee, speak in thy audience, and hear the words of thine handmaiden. Let not my Lord, I pray thee, regard this man of Belial, even Nabal. For as his name is, so is he. Nabal is his name, and folly is with him. But I, thine handmaid, saw not the young men of the Lord, of my Lord, whom thou didst send. Now therefore, my Lord, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, seeing the Lord hath withholden thee from coming to shed blood, and from avenging thyself with thine own hand. Now let thine enemies and they that seek evil of my Lord be as Nabal. And now this blessing which thine handmaiden hath brought unto my Lord, let it even be given unto your young men that follow my Lord. And I pray, forgive the trespass of thy handmaid, for the Lord will certainly make my Lord a sure house, because my Lord fighteth the battles of the Lord, and evil hath not been found in thee all thy days. Yet a man is risen to pursue thee and to seek thy soul, but the soul of my Lord shall be bound in the bundle of life with the Lord thy God, and the souls of thine enemies shall be slung out as out of the middle of a sling. And it shall come to pass, when the Lord shall have done to my Lord according to all the good that he had spoken concerning thee, and shall have appointed thee ruler over Israel, that this shall be no grief unto thee, nor offense of heart unto my Lord, either that thou hast shed blood causeless, or that my Lord hath avenged himself. But when the Lord shall have dealt well with my Lord, then remember thine handmaiden. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word, and let his word be food to our souls. This is the story of David after the death of Samuel. And it talks about how David in the wilderness had found this man Nabal's shearers of sheep, and had actually protected them and shielded them from attacks of enemies, and allowed them to carry out their responsibilities, and in doing so did not even take one sheep, one gift from them for what they had done. David was so integrous, he was a man of integrity, until he did not, even though he deserved, whenever one would do good to you in the Bible, and especially under the old covenant, when someone would do good to you, then you had a responsibility to pay them or to give them for their service. And so David had protected Nabal's shearers, and now, praise God, he didn't even ask them for anything in return. But David did send. He understood protocol. He sent to Nabal. He didn't deal with the shearers in the sense of getting what he needed for his men and for him, as far as their what they needed to eat or what they needed to sustain them. He sent to Nabal and said to Nabal that, you know, when I as your men were out shearing the sheep and doing your bidding, we my men that are with me, praise God, we protected them, we kept them shielded from any attacks of the enemy, so that they could carry out their responsibility. We protected them day and night. We became, praise God, a garrison around them, a protection around them, and so we did this good thing because there could have been things that would have taken place. You could have lost sheep because of raiders that would come, but we protected them. Now, what I'm asking you is, if you will help us and give us, some food, and give us some things that will help us because we have helped you. But Nabal said, look, who is this man David? Who is he? Who do he think he is? You know, I don't care what you've done. I don't care what you say. You know what? I ain't giving you nothing. That's the paraphrase version. I'm not giving you anything. Now, the thing that I want you to see is this, is that this is really a critical time in David's progress and David's journey to his destiny. In other words, praise God, David is on the journey, on the way to his destiny. And this is a significant incident. This is a significant trap of the enemy that was set up to cause David to not be able to walk in his destiny with a clear conscience, and that he had not violated and did the very thing that he was running from Saul wanting to murder an innocent person. But he would have had not only would he have, he said, I'm going to get my sword. I want y'all to get y'all's sword. This man say he's not going to give me anything, and we protected them. He said, I'm going to kill every, and I'm going to put it in a better way. He said, I'm going to kill every man. Every male is going to be killed. I'm going to kill Nabal, and I'm killing every male in his family, every male in his group. I'm killing all of them. I want you to see something here. Let me show you something. Just turn back to the 23rd chapter of 1 Samuel. Because David has already been declared, he has already been anointed by God to be the king. How many know that was David's destiny, to be king over Israel? He had already been anointed by Samuel to be king over Israel. And praise God. In 1 Samuel chapter 23, starting at the 15th verse, Jonathan speaking over David. And it says, and David saw that Saul was come out to seek his life, and David was in the wilderness of Ziz in the wood. Verse 16 says, and Jonathan, Saul's son, arose and went to David into the wood and strengthened his hand in God. Verse 17 said, and he said unto him, fear not, for the hand of Saul my father shall not find thee, and thou shalt be king over Israel, and I shall be next unto thee, and that also Saul my father knoweth it. In other words, praise God, David's destiny was to be king. Not only did David know it, but also Saul knew it, the present king, and Jonathan, his covenant friend, who was the son of Saul, knew it. And everybody knew that David was going to be king. This was not something that was not known. So even the Nabal had heard that David had fought the Lord's battles and he would be king. That was David's destiny. But this incident almost aborted his destiny. Almost aborted his destiny. I want to go back to the 25th chapter and look at verse 31, because I'm going to read it in the Amplified translation. It says, this is Abigail. Let me just preface this before I read that verse. Nabal said, I won't give you nothing. I don't care who you are, who you think you are. He knew that David was to be king. It was common knowledge. Folk was, the crowds were saying, Saul killed his 1,000, David killed his 10,000. They knew that David was to be king, even though Saul was trying to kill him. And so it was common knowledge that he was to be king. And so Nabal dishonored the purpose of God for David's life. He says, look, I'm not going to give you anything. I don't care what you did. Who do you think you are? Nabal was like that. His name means curlish. His name means that he was one scripture says he was a son of Belial. In other words, praise God, he was a wicked man. He was a curlish man. He was an ignorant man. He had a lot of wealth, but he was ignorant. Reminds me of somebody else. But anyway. And so he said, I'm not going to give you anything. Now, one of the men that kept Nabal's sheep went and told Abigail. Well, I'm telling you something. Sometimes, men, we need a good, wise woman around us. Even the women could at least say amen. One of her men came and said, look, when we were out there, we were protected by David. David's men kept us. We were able to do our job. Didn't lose one sheep. Didn't lose anything. And praise God on behalf of our master. And he sent his men down to just get something from him. And he dissed him. He just railed. And the scripture said he railed on him. In other words, just an ignorant man. Get out of my face. I ain't giving you nothing. I don't care who you are. But Abigail heard when they told Abigail. Abigail gathered up some food, gathered some sheep. She gathered up some, and she went after David. Because the young man told her, said, "There's some, David has been getting ready to do something around here." Look, say this with me. Say, your response determines your destiny. Say it again. Your response determines your destiny. There is no such thing as you not ever being in a place where someone will diss you or do you wrong or cuss you out or do something wrong to you. It is your response that determines your destiny. David is now mad. Now, if you were here on Wednesday, you know I taught about offense. The first time that someone was offended in the Bible was Cain. And the Bible says that Cain got mad. Cain got angry. In the Amplified Translation, it said he got indignant. You know, all of us have gotten indignant sometime or another. And the Bible says that God said to Cain, he said, Cain, if you do well, I will accept you. If you do it my way, I will bless you. But I'm not going to accept out of the cursed ground an offering that I already done cursed. See, let me tell you something. God is not going to change the way he does things for you. You're going to have to conform to his will and his purpose. He ain't changing for you. So he said to Cain, he said, Cain, if you do well, because Cain brought the fruit of the ground, Abel brought the blood sacrifice that represented the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And God said, if you do well, you'll be accepted. In other words, I'll give you another chance. Look at somebody and say, your response will determine your destiny. Cain was the oldest. Cain was entitled to the double portion. You don't know what that is? Get my message on destined for the double portion. Because that the oldest always got a double portion, because he was responsible for the whole family if the father died. And so when God said, Cain, if you do well, I'll bless you, Cain's response determined his destiny. What was Cain's response? Cain got mad, got angry, got depressed, had hatred in his heart toward his brother. He was offended by God. He was offended with his brother. And you know the story. He called his brother out and killed his brother. Murdered his brother. Look at somebody and say, your response determines your destiny. If you don't deal with offense, if you don't learn how to deal with not being offended, your life will wander. And God said to Cain this. He said, Cain, he said, you will be a fugitive, a vagabond, and the earth will not give you a harvest. I'm going to get back to David in a minute, but God's just segued me over here because somebody here needs to hear this. Because what we need to understand is that sometimes we are in a cycle of defeat. And we are blaming the devil. And really, it is not the devil. It was your response to your situation. It was your response to your going through. It was your response to your persecution. It was your response to what folk did to you. It was your response to being raped. It was your response to being divorced. It was your response, praise God, to going through life. Look at your neighbor and say, your response determines your destiny. You will wander through life. You will be a believer. I'm not saying you're not going to make it to heaven, but you will not enjoy the trip. I don't know about you. I'm on my way to heaven and I'm enjoying the trip. And you must understand that people wander all the way through their life wondering who they are. They get off into all kinds of things. Because why? Because they're responding to stuff that happened to all of us. Man in this life is of a few days and full of trouble. Look at your neighbor and say, trouble is coming your way. Whether you like it or not. I don't care whether you're saved. I don't care whether you're baptized with the Holy Ghost. I don't care whether your mom and daddy was saved. I don't care whether you're a church member. I don't care whether you're a good person. Trouble is coming your way. But your response determines your destiny. Thank you, Jesus. And God said, you will wander as a vagabond. We have cast devils, vagabond demons out of people. Can't be stay put nowhere. 32 churches in 32 days. They've been a member of 32 churches in 32 days. I know I'm exaggerating, but I'm giving. They wander from church to church and from place to place. They're trying to find their place, and they don't understand, praise God, that God has a plan and a purpose for their life. And that life stuff is going to happen. We're going to go through some persecution. Folk going to do us wrong. But our response, is anybody in here, determines our destiny. How you respond. David got his sword. David said, get y'all sword. This man didn't cuss me out when I didn't done them right. Have you ever done somebody right and then they did you wrong? Have you ever given yourself, all yourself to somebody, and then praise God, they turn on you? But the problem is that what you must understand is, praise God, that every one of us that live in the earth, this fallen world, this is a fallen world. It's under a curse. It's waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God to determine its renovation. We must understand that you are going to go through some things, praise God, and you're going to have to suffer some things. Your response. Is anybody in here? Will determine your destiny. David is about to do something that is very bad. And that's what we have to understand. It's not when things come our way, when trials come our way. I know you've been raped, but your response will determine your destiny. Do you know that actually your strength is made perfect in your, God's strength in your life is made perfect in your weakness? That when you think you are the weakest is when you're the strongest. See, so David is now, it's not going to be long before David is going to be king over Israel. But now the devil comes, and the devil, David is offended. How you know he's offended? He said, look, get y'all's gun, get the guns, get your knife. Cause now this is, I know it might sound a little cruel, but this is the way the Bible said. He said, if I don't kill every one of Nabal and people in his house that pisses against the wall. You know what he's talking about? He's talking about males, men. I'm going to kill them all. Have you ever felt that way? Somebody do you wrong, you be saying, get my gun. I'm going off on somebody around here. Here it is. I done done you right. I done done what you had. I done been good to you. And now, you mean you going to give me evil for the good I done done to you? See, David said, it was not my enemies that provoked me or forsake, because then I could have borne it. And it'll happen with people that you love the most, people that you serve the most, people, praise God. David said, you are my common friend. We went to church together. So we all been done wrong. God had to teach me something, because as a pastor, I'm going to tell you something. It ain't easy being a pastor. It ain't easy being a shepherd over people. Because the very people that you love and you serve sometimes can turn on you. And the Lord had to teach me. He said, son, you cannot be affected by every time somebody do you wrong, every time somebody lead a church, every time somebody, praise God, talk about you, every time somebody disagree with you. You cannot be affected by it. I choose not to be offended. Because my response determines my. Hallelujah. I know I'm preaching better than you saying amen, but that's all right. God has a plan for every one of our lives. God is the one that caused you to be in the earth. It wasn't your mama and your daddy. God determined, and God has a plan for your life. God has already, the Bible says, the steps of a good man is ordered by the Lord. God has already laid out your steps. A plan for everybody's life. But how many don't even reach their destiny? Don't even get to the destiny that God has for them. Don't even get to the place where God wants for them, because, praise God, because of their response to the trials. So God has a plan for your life. He had a plan for David's life. And David is going to be king over Israel. But now he's going to commit the same thing that Saul was trying to commit to him. Saul was trying to kill David, an innocent man. Let me tell you something. He was going to kill Nabal. Nabal might have cussed him out, but the other men didn't cuss him out. He said, I ain't going to kill Nabal, but every man I see in Nabal's house, I don't care if they were there or not, I'm killing them too. That was his response. So get y'all's guns, boy. Get your sword. And then the Bible said he got his sword. Somebody say, thank God for a wise woman. So thank God for a wise wife. I didn't hear no man say nothing, man. But Abigail was a wise woman. I'm gonna tell you something. I ain't going there. She was a wise woman. She had married, and one translation said that Nabal was a fool. I'll just tell you something. Women don't marry a fool. And Nabal was about to get everybody killed. But when she heard it, she got the stuff that David should have got in the first place and took it to him. And she bowed down before him and said, David, you're going to be king. You got a destiny. There's a purpose on your life. If you respond this way, it's going to be bad on your conscience. You're going to have it on your conscience forever. Look at the verse 31 again. Verse 31, 1 Samuel 25, 31. And it says in the Amplified, this shall be no staggering grief to you, or cause for pangs of conscience to to my Lord. In other words, your conscience is going to bother you. Even if you get to your destiny, it's not going to be, you're not going to be there, praise God, without guilt. You're going to feel like, I came to this place, but I had to backstab and kill and do everything else to get there. Let me tell you something. God can get you your destiny, and you don't have to, praise God, step on everybody on your way there. He said, this shall no staggering grief to you or cause for pangs of conscience to my Lord, either that you have shed blood without cause or that my Lord has avenged himself. And when the Lord has dealt well with my Lord, then earnestly remember thy hand. In other words, she's saying to him, she's saying, David, because in 31st in King James, it says that this shall be no grief unto thee, nor offense of heart. In other words, praise God, if you respond the wrong, because see, what you have to understand is, and especially under the old covenant, that the judgment of God, when David killed general that he killed, Uriah, who was Bathsheba's husband, God judged him. See, don't think that God judges sin. God will judge sin and still take you to heaven. You just might get there a little earlier. I don't know about you, but praise God, I'm going to heaven, but I'm not going today. I don't want to go today. God would have had to judge him for the innocent blood that he would have shed there, and it would have affected his destiny. Look at somebody say, my response determines my destiny. And so she helped him. The wise woman, she said, look, don't do this. Don't you do this. I know you have a right to take him out. You know, I got a right. I said, look, you better learn how to do like Jesus said. Jesus said, bless those that curse you. Pray for those that despitefully use you. Do you know that is a kingdom principle that helps you get to your destiny? So don't you do this. No, don't do this, David, because if you do this, God's going to have to judge you. He said, you're going to be king, man. You're about to mess it all up. You're about to commit murder. Thank God for this woman. And David said in the 32nd verse, and David said, Abigail, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, which sent thee this day to meet me. Thank God, God sent you to meet me, because I'm about to take everybody out. That's the way some of y'all is. Y'all know some of y'all when y'all was in the world. Y'all know what y'all did when y'all was in the world. Well, you know, in other words, I ain't gonna just kill you. I'm killing you, your mama, your daddy, your auntie, your uncle. I'm killing everybody. I'm mad. And I'm gonna tell you, you've got to learn how to not respond the way you used to respond. You have to work on yourself. You have to present your body a living sacrifice. You have to change the way you think. You come in the world, praise God, and you know in the world you learn, the golden rule, get them before they get you. And then the Bible says, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Not what they did to you, but what you would have them do unto you. I'm going to be through soon. It's tight, but it's right. David said, you've kept me from aborting my destiny. You kept me from responding in the wrong way. Let me say this to you, saints of God. Don't get mad at folk that God put in your life to stop you from doing something crazy. Don't get mad at the pastor when he say, okay, now, no, don't do that. Don't get mad at the pastor when he tells you, don't respond like that. Respond like this. He is not trying to change, praise God, and make you in his image. But what he's trying to do is he's trying to let you know that if you respond the wrong way, you could abort your destiny. Let me give you the next point that I want to give you. Say this with me. Say, my destiny is a journey, not a destination. Say it again. My journey is a, my destiny is a journey and not a destination. Why is that important? That point is important to know, is that David's destiny was not just predicated on the fact that in the future he would be a king, but it was how he got there, the process that he had to go through till he got there. We have the example of this so prominently and very quickly, is if we look at the life of Joseph, we will see perfect example of God saying to a person and outlining their destiny at an early age and telling Joseph that you're going to be a ruler. Your brothers are going to bow down to you. Your father is going to bow down to you. Boy, you got a dream. And praise God. And then the next thing you know, they had enthroned him in the pit. Look at somebody say, stuff happens. People get hit. This is his brothers. This is his brother. They didn't throw him in a ditch. And then they sell him into slavery. And when he gets to Potiphar's house, look at somebody say, his response to being sold as a slave was favor. Oh, he could have got down to Potiphar's house and said, you know what? They didn't did me wrong. I'm gonna do him wrong. I'm gonna steal him blind. No, his response. The Bible says that when Potiphar looked on him, he saw God's favor on his life. In other words, praise God, you can't respond. You can't respond like you did in the world. You can't do stuff like that. You can't be in the kingdom and doing in the light and doing kingdom darkness stuff. You mess up and you abort the very purpose. If Joseph had it had an attitude like some of us had an attitude because somebody did us wrong, praise God, Potiphar and his wife would have got hurt. He gets thrown in the prison falsely. Did good and bad come to you? How many of us have been through that? I know all this good and here it is, ain't nothing but bad coming to me. But your response, it's not what happened to you, it's how you responded to it. It's how you dealt with it. He's in prison. Instead of him being in prison, I'm in prison. It's just bad things always happen to good people. And look like God didn't turn his back on me. But the Bible says when he got to the prison, there was favor on his life, and he was put over all the prisoners in the prison. See, your destiny is not a destination. If you treat your destiny as a destination, you know what you'll do? I'm just waiting for you'll be on hold waiting to get to your destination. But if you understand that all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord and are called according to purpose, that God has taken every bad thing, every hit, every burden, every trial, every situation, and using it to get you to your destiny. Destiny is not a destination, it's a journey. Thank you, Jesus. So he gets into prison. Look at somebody and say, go through the process. Let God process you. You better be practicing your prophetic while you're going through. Some folk waiting, praise God. Well, see, I'm waiting until they give me a mic. And look, you need to be prophesying, praise God, in the prison. In other words, Joseph was in the prison. And when the baker and the butler came to the prison, I want to ask you a question. Can you prophesy in your prison? Or does everything have to be going right for you to prophesy? He's in the prison. He could be bitter. He could be angry. But his response determined his destiny. The baker and the butler could have come down there and he could have said, I ain't prophesying no more. He could have been like Jeremiah. Jeremiah got so bad, he said, look, I can't prophesy no more. But the fire of God was so in his bone, he said, it's just like fire. I said, I got to prophesy. He could have been so mad until, praise God, he didn't even associate with any other. He could have isolated himself like some of us do. We don't come to church, no. We isolate ourselves. No. It was his response that determined his destiny. So when the baker and butler came down and was talking, he prophesied over them, told them what their dream meant. And when the butler, I believe it was the butler that was restored. I don't know, one of them. When he was restored back to Pharaoh, Pharaoh had a dream. See, don't be seething in your problems and your situation. You got to learn, praise God, that you got to rejoice and praise him, praise God, when you're going through. You got to learn, praise God, how to lift your hands and praise God even when folk are doing you wrong. You got to learn, praise God, how when folk do you wrong, I'm not going to do them wrong because I'm operating, because I got a destiny and a purpose, and I am not going to abort my destiny by my response. Robashata. So when he interpreted the dreams of the butler and the baker, and when they were restored back, when the butler was restored back, and Pharaoh had his dream, Pharaoh had a dream nobody could interpret. Butler say, "Hey, Your Highness, I was in prison." Hey, glory. David said, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. It don't make no difference what I have to go through. I can go through hell, praise God, and praise God, I'll prophesy in hell. You can tell when folk really got it is when they're going through, praise God, and they still lifting their hands. They're going through and they still shouting and praising. They're going through, praise God. You wouldn't even know, praise God, that they're going through because they have determined that I am not going to respond like you think I ought to respond, devil. I'm not going to be mad. I'm not going to be upset. I'm not going to be fighting. I'm not going to be cussing. I'm going to bless those that curse me. I'm going to pray for those that despitefully use me because my response determines my destiny. Shato kataba shata. When you're going through some things and folk coming at you, you got to just say, no offense, but I'm on my way to my destiny. I ain't got time to get mad. I ain't got time to get bound up in hatred. And I ain't got time to be mad at the last pastor and the deacon, praise God. I ain't got time because I'm on my way to my destiny. Look at somebody say, I'm going somewhere. I ain't got time for offense because I'm going somewhere. See, I ain't worried about folk ain't going nowhere. I'm going somewhere. Hey, glory to God. Hallelujah. Say, Your Highness, there's a man down in prison. We was all in chains down there. And he was interpreting. He was having a prophetic service in prison. Said, bring him up here. And when he got up there, and he interpreted Pharaoh's dream. And Pharaoh said, well, you know what? Ain't nobody else around here interpreted nothing around here. You must be the man. And the Bible says he gave him his signet ring, and he was second in command. You know, that signet ring was the ring that they would when they would sign, they wouldn't sign their signature. Whenever they would sign on he would take and Joseph was wearing his signet ring. And he said, everybody will answer to you. Nobody, praise God, will have any more authority than you except for me. It's because of his response. The Lord was showing me as he was giving me this message, he said, David. And I said, David. And then he took me to this. And then he said, and Joseph. And then he said, and Jabez. And I went over and looked at Jabez. And you know what Jabez, the Bible says his mother bore him in pain, and his name meant pain. Can you imagine being born in pain? Now, they don't say nothing about his father. Maybe he didn't. Maybe his father left. It just says that his mother had him and bore him in pain, and praise God. Can you imagine you name your child Pain? But instead of him responding that, oh, I was born in a single mother home, I don't know who my daddy is, I never got a hug, your response determine your destiny. Jabez said, Lord, hey, bless me. Let me not be grieved. Let these things that I've gone through, praise God, be a stepping stone, praise God, to my blessing. Bless me, Lord. And the Bible says God blessed him. Why? Because of his response. What is your response when folk do you wrong? I know what we learned. I told y'all last week. My older brothers taught me how to fight. You know, it was 15 of us, 10 boys. I'm number 13. I'm the second youngest boy. So all my brothers and the Hogans in Southwest Detroit, when I went to school, folks said, "Are you a Hogan?" I said, "Yeah." See, don't, and they would say, "Don't mess with him, man. He got about 100 brothers." See, I mean, that's serious. Now, they knew it was exaggerating, you know. They were like, "No, don't mess with him, man." My older brother said, "Look, no, don't play. Look, don't let them be pushing around." See, because you know, they didn't already experience, so they teaching me. They say, look, you know, okay, you know, because back then, you know, you say, you were getting ready to fight, they put something on your shoulder, say, knock it off your shoulder. So my brother say, okay, when they put it on his shoulder for you to knock it off, just knock him right in the mouth. Knock him out. See, that's what you learn in the world, so you come into the church. We bring the sacrifice of praise. Then somebody step on your toe. Wait. Your response determines your destiny. Finally, let me close with this. I got 3 more minutes. See, I'm watching the clock. I got 3 minutes. Romans 8 and 28 is one of the most powerful. Actually, the whole chapter 8 of Romans is one of the most powerful revelations that you could ever get. Because it speaks to our weaknesses and the Holy Spirit's help for our weaknesses. One thing the Lord showed me last night, he took me to Paul when Paul had his thorn in the flesh, where Paul said, I glory in my tribulation, in my infirmity, in my weakness. God said, my grace is made, my strength is made perfect in your weakness. And the Lord began to let me, he began to let me know. He said, son, if people would find what their weakness is, they would find their strength. That's a mouthful. When God downloads something like that, I just sat there down there and just kind of meditated on it. And he began to tell me, he said, you remember when you felt so weak and weary and looked like, you know, you were so vulnerable? He said, and you notice how I came, how everything began, I worked it out and brought you through and broke you through and made a way out of no way. He said, because when you realized how weak you were, you humbled yourself and turned to me with all of your heart. See, your weakness many times can be your greatest strength. Because when you feel like you can't make it, you got to get out on your knees and you got to cry out to God. You say, I can't do this by myself. Let me tell you something. You can't respond the way you need to respond unless God gives you some grace. You better do like the apostles did when Jesus told them about offense. And they said, how many times do I have to forgive my brother? Seven times? And Jesus said, no, seven times 70 in one day. And you know what they said? And you know what Peter said? Peter said, increase my faith. All y'all faith people in here, y'all need to ask God to increase your faith. I got to be able to believe that God will fight for me. I got to be able to believe that vengeance belongs to the Lord. I got to be able to believe that even when folk do me wrong and I do them right, I have placed them in the hands of God, and God will fight my battle. Quit trying to fight your own battles. Quit trying to fight your own battles. I learned, I said, Lord, how can I do it? They did me wrong. I want to go upside their head, but I'm going to pray for them. I'm going to bless them. In this same scripture, and I'm closing because my time is up. In the same scripture, Abigail said to David, she said, David will not have a guilty conscience for having avenged yourself. I just want to tell you, quit trying to fight your own battles and avenge yourself. Look at somebody, say, vengeance belongs to the Lord. God will take care of it. I know he ain't moving as quickly as you think, because you want him to get him right away. I know what I'm talking about. I know. You can't, you know, there's a natural response to certain things. Some of us, our reflex, it's just our reflex. Somebody hit you, And then God tells you, bless those that curse you. Pray for those that despitefully use you. Don't respond in the way that they think you should respond. This saved David's kingship. This woman with the wisdom, David did not abort his destiny. Joseph's attitude of not being offended caused him to get to his destiny. Your destiny is a journey. It's ordered by the Lord. One of the things the Lord showed me one time, he said to me, I have ordered your footsteps. He said, but they're not always to walk in the sunshine. I have purposely taken you through certain things so that I could prepare you for your destiny. And so there's some things you needed, there's some trials that you needed to go through to get to where I want you to get to. Stand on your feet. I hope you receive something today. But remember, your response, oh my God. I didn't say it over and over again. Say your response determines your destiny. Say this, my response determines my destiny. See, it is not what people do to you. It's how you respond. And I could go through the Bible over and over again and show you over and over again where when the right response was, that it protected the purpose of God over their lives. I know you're going through. Some of you are going through. But you got to know how to respond. When people come at you, you got to know how to respond. Because if you respond in the wrong way, you lose out. And sometimes it doesn't mean that you don't get to your destiny. Sometimes your destiny is delayed. Sometimes you're delayed because you didn't learn the lesson. Because see, if you don't pass the test, you don't finish the course. And sometimes we don't pass the test and we have to go through and take a makeup exam. Some of us have been taking makeup exams like it's going out of style. Bam! I didn't hit somebody. Oh Lord, I need a makeup. Your response. Thank you, Jesus. Selah. Your response determine your destiny. Now, whatever God's got to make up in your life, He can do it. But you're gonna have to learn. You're gonna have to get over that place. Sometimes it's like getting over the hump. It's like getting over that. You got to let God reconfigure you. I was telling someone, I was saying, look, have you ever let God gut you? And so the person was like, they were telling me all this stuff, all this peripheral. I said, have you ever let God gut you down to the bone? Because the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword. It pierces the dividing of sunder of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, thoughts and intents of the heart. Have you ever let God gut you down to the bone, between the marrow and the bone, between the thoughts and the intents of your heart? Because if you respond in the wrong way, there's some things that you need to let God just gut you. You need to surrender. And then you need to have enough faith to believe that God can have vengeance. You ain't got to take vengeance out on everybody. Vengeance is the Lord's. Don't avenge yourself. Sometimes folk do you wrong, praise God. Instead of you trying to stand up for yourself, Jesus said, agree with your adversaries on the way. In other words, praise God, I'm not going to get all caught up in that. I'm going to love you anyway. I don't care what you say about me. I'm going to love you. You can't stop me from loving you. I'm going to walk in love because I want God's best. I want to walk in God's purpose and plan for my life. And I am not going to live my life in the circle and in the cycle of vagabond, fugitive, and no harvest. Thank you, Jesus. Lift your hands and close your eyes. I do it like this because I could call you up. I could call you to the altar and come to the altar, but just between you and God, you know how you've been responding. You know what your responses have been. And some of them have not been good. Now what you got to understand is that I need to learn and meditate and bless those that curse me. Pray for those that despitefully use me. Lord, I'm not going to respond the way the devil wants me to respond. I get bad news, I'm not going to respond the way the devil wants me to respond, because my response determines my destiny. Just lift your hand and say, Lord Jesus, you determine my destiny and the purpose for my life. Lord, give me the ability, the grace to respond to my adversaries the correct way. Those that speak against me, help me to bless them. Those that curse me, Help me to pray and bless them. Lord, help me with my response to my trial, to my tribulation, to persecution, to infirmity, in Jesus' name. Because my response determines my destiny. Lord, say this, on this journey, I know there will be trials, tribulations, persecution, trouble. It befalls all of us. But Lord, I'm going to respond to my trials differently than I've done in the past. I'm going to react out of a spirit of love and not of a spirit of revenge. Lord, give me grace to respond correctly to your process. In Jesus' name. Come on, put your hands together and give God praise. Come on, give him praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to just say this. Say, my destiny is greater than my past. My destiny is greater than my past. See, God has a destiny for each and every one of us. And he doesn't send us to the university to get trained. He doesn't send us to vocational school to get trained. You know where he trains us? In the school of life. He knew that your mama and daddy wasn't married when you were born. Your response to it will determine your destiny. Oh, I know I've been divorced. He knows you've been divorced, but your response to it determines your destiny. It's not what happened to you, it's how you respond to it. And when you start changing your responses, thank you, Jesus. It's going to take crucifying your flesh. You know, because a dead man, you can't offend a dead man. God said, mortify the deeds of the flesh. Folks be thinking you're going to get mad. You mean you ain't mad? I mean, one time somebody was telling me, you mean you ain't mad? I said, no, I ain't mad. It was like, that's strange. You should be mad. You know, see, that's what we think. Well, I should be mad. They did me that way. No, I'm not mad because I got a destiny. I'm going somewhere. And I'm going to give them the benefit of that. Maybe they had a bad day. Maybe that was, you know, you give people the benefit of the doubt. Say, look, I'm not coming down. I'm on my journey to my destiny, and I am not going to be knocked down and knocked off the road by offense. Thank you, Jesus. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're in this place and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're not born again.